The following program is brought to you in part by Logisticare, the nation's leading provider of specialized transportation network management to state and local government clients. By Maine's credit unions, now is the time for a credit union. There is one for you. And by MacPage, developing relationships, earning trust, addressing complex issues, and making a difference.
Welcome to Pingree and Katz, the Maine event. In our left corner, we have Hannah Pingree, former House Majority Leader and Speaker of the House. In our right corner, we have Senator Roger Katz of Augusta, representing District 24. This week, Roger and Hannah have assembled a panel of experts to discuss tough Maine issues affecting the entire state. To wrap it up, we'll visit with Gary Crocker as he gives us his view from West Godna. It's all right here with Pingree and Katz, the Maine event.
I mean, we're in the heart of the season now. I mean, people are already tired of the TV ads, lots of money pouring in from around the country on Maine elections, so many races to talk about. You know, what are you thinking so far, Josh?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of issues out there. We know that jobs and the economy, we've got a closely contested gubernatorial race. We know that there's outside money. Just happy that we've got two great guests today in Mal Leary and Professor Jim Melcher.
Yeah, I think we have a good conversation going up. We have so much to talk about that we won't be able to fit into this time, but kind of money being spent on these races, the kind of ads that we're seeing. We've got a big race in the second CD. Might even talk about legislative races. So we have a great show coming up. My name is Hannah Pingree, and welcome to the Maine event. I'm here with my co-host, Josh Tardy. And we've got an excellent show where we're going to talk to some longtime political followers, people who have been following politics longer than Josh and I have been paying attention. So we have a great show for you, and we will be right back.
At MacPage, we believe in developing relationships, earning trust, addressing complex issues, and making a difference. We enjoy the people we serve and care about the work we do, providing integrated accounting, consulting, and tax services to our clients throughout New England and across the country. Please visit us at MacPage.com to learn more.
Wow. College already.
Yeah. We gotta go.
For all those times you stood by me, for all the...
And remember that...
Seatbelt. Drive safe. Call in and get there.
I love you.
Every dream you make true. For all the love I found in you.
I love you too, Daddy.
You're the one who saw me through.
And thanks for everything.
Gratitude. Pass it on. A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
The trend is clear. More Maine people are joining credit unions. The reasons are clear. Credit unions offer something different from banks. True financial value. Loan rates that are usually lower. Products and services with low fees or none at all. That's because credit unions are owned by their members. People just like you, who create a community that welcomes you wherever you are in life. Discover why a credit union is your best financial choice. Now is the time.
Welcome back. We have, Josh and I have two great guests who are political veterans, have been following elections and politics for a long time. I'm going to introduce Mal Leary, who Josh and I spent a lot of time with in the State House. He's the
managing... More time than you wish.
More time? Right. No, never. he's the managing editor of Capital Connection for Maine Public Broadcasting. So welcome, Mal.
Thanks for being here.
We'd also like to welcome Professor James Melcher from the University of Maine at Farmington, political science expert, professor, and happy to have your input on today's show.
My pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
So, question for both of you. Obviously, the big race is the governor's race. A lot of dynamics in a three-way race. I'd love to just kind of hear, first off, your take on how it's going, anything that's surprising you about the race, Care to make predictions? We'll start with you, Jim.
I've been a little surprised that Elliot Cutler hasn't been able to get past 20%. You know, the one poll that he got him to 19% seems to have been dropping back in some of the more recent things. I think it's getting very late for him to make a move because there's so many strategic voters that are going to see this as a referendum about the governor, are going to look for a stronger candidate. Governor's support continues to stay very solid. He's got that really strong core of support. Yep. So watching on that side is the interesting thing. Of course, the debates were just such a funny sideshow to, are they debating? Are they not debating? And, you know, certainly with the governor, the unexpected is the expected.
Yeah.
So then 5 days later, he's back in. So I'm not going to tell you that I knew that was coming. Yep. But it's, I think, the kind of campaign and the kind of issues we expected for the most part.
Yeah.
Well, the debate about the debates is absolutely interesting.
Exactly.
But how about some of the current events, such as mill closings, mill openings? What impact do you see that those type of factors have on a governor's race?
Me or Mal?
Either.
Okay.
I think they have some impact, but I think what you started to talk about, Jim, is the huge amount of money that's coming into the governor's race.
Yeah.
You start looking at the races this year compared to 4 years ago, the money is actually astronomical. The Republican Governors Association alone is dumping $3 million into this race. Democrats have several political action committees also putting money in. The campaigns are raising money. And that might be part of the reason why Cutler's not making traction, because Cutler's there financing mostly his own campaign. He has no independent expenditures. He's not accepting PAC money. The two major party candidates are. They're spending huge amounts of money. You can't watch a program on television without seeing back-to-back ads. And some of the ads are attacking the other guy. So I have seen literally the sequence of for Michu against LePage, for LePage, against LePage, back to Michu again, all in the course of like 15 minutes on the air. So the outstanding thing about this race, I think, is the huge amount of money that's being spent. And it's also way beyond just television. That's what we're talking about, because it's easy to track that. But they're on Facebook. They're on Google. They're doing direct mail. They're doing every single tool in the arsenal of a campaign.
And they're not talking about Elliot Cutler. I mean, the ads are all LePage versus Michaud. Yeah. It's almost as though Elliot Cutler isn't in the room. To go back to the Mills question, almost any election in Maine is going to largely be about economic issues. You know, who is going to do the better job? What tax policy is going to be better for this? This highlights that. It draws a big underline about that. But that was already going to be one of the leading issues. Yeah. And, you know, I don't know that any of the candidates could say that there was that much they could have done differently. We're seeing these same paper mill dynamics in Wisconsin, in Minnesota, in lots and lots of states. So I think it's difficult for any of them to say, I would have waved my magic wand and none of this would be different. But it just highlights economic issues that I think here are so much bigger. And people looking at this race from outside don't always see that. A lot of people looking at this from outside say, this is the race about, are you going to have the first gay governor in the country? Yeah. I don't hear hardly anyone talking about
that. We haven't talked about
that, have we? The one person talked about it really has been Elliot Cutler. You know, has really attacked Michaud from his left on, he hasn't been a consistent enough environmentalist. He didn't come out for same-sex marriage quick enough. He's really the only person talking about those things. And I think people from outside of Maine don't really realize how much that's true.
And what other issues are you seeing resonate? I mean, what are we seeing these ads about? What are the people talking about? And, you know, what is playing out in the media, especially the paid media?
Well, what's really interesting is what the candidates are portraying as the issues and what the voters are seeing as an issue. For example, Governor LePage is making welfare reform a big issue. His campaign ads, his speeches, he's trying to do that. But when you look at the polling data, it's just what Jim is talking about. The overwhelming question people want answered is, what are you going to do to make this place better? What are you going to do so my kids can find a job and not have to move out of state, as one of mine did, in order to find a job in his field? That's what people are talking about. So there is a disconnect here between what the campaigns are trying to make the issue and what the voters want to hear answers about.
As they say, it's the economy, stupid.
That's right.
Let's go back to the campaign ads. We've heard for years negative politics has no place in Maine. Is that the case? Have we changed? And do they work?
I think they can be very effective. A lot of the negative ads, the most negative ones, are the ones that come from out of state. And I think we've seen that in the past. I think in a number of cases, that's wound up backfiring. But I think some of that is a function of the governor's personality. And what I would add to what Mal was saying, I wouldn't disagree with any of it, but I think a lot of the advertising is about personality. Has Mike Michaud shown that he has enough gumption to accomplish things in Congress? Is the governor embarrassing or a wonderful truth teller? So I think some of that is a function of the governor, but I think a lot of it is out-of-state people that don't quite grasp Maine political culture. And I think a lot of the time that really winds up backfiring.
No.
I think that what's going to happen with the voters is they are going to get fed up the closer we get to election, because the number of ads are going to be just so much. I mean, you're not going to be able to watch the World Series. You're not going to be able to watch the football games on the weekend without seeing these political ads constantly. And that's going to be a turnoff to a lot of folks. And at some point, they're going to get fed up and say enough is enough. And to follow up on Jim's point on Cutler, that's the only chance I see Cutler having in this, is all the negative ads attacking LePage and Michaud finally get enough voters to say, enough, these guys, I'm not going to vote for either one of them.
Yeah.
But whether they vote for Cutler is a big question.
Yeah. So, Mal, you brought in some numbers, and you've both been following this for a long time. What is different this election in terms of spending on especially the governor's race?
It is obscene, the amount of money being spent. In part because the Supreme Court a few years ago, in a series of court rulings, just opened the floodgates. We're seeing more money being spent in the governor's race than we have ever seen before. As of the 1st of October, if I remember this correctly, over $6.5 million had been spent in the governor's race by the campaigns.
Wow.
The independent spending was $3 to $4 million. It's really hard to tell because it's more difficult to track that because of the reporting requirements are different on the independent committees. But the best we can find out is huge amounts of money. Just before we taped this program, I follow the FCC, Federal Communications Commission, database every day, which looks at where people are actually spending the money. We see that before it shows up as an expenditure. Crossroads, Carl Rove's group, $100,000 in 1 week on one Portland television station.
Wow, a lot of ads. Last word on money, Jim.
Well, and following on what Mal said, I think it's a lot of it is the out-of-state money that surprises people. And I think a lot of it is you have so many fewer candidates running as clean elections candidates for the legislature. I live in Augusta. I just got a mailer from a national real estate PAC based in Chicago. Now, Matt Pouliot is a realtor and a very good one. Yep. You see his signs around town. I don't remember seeing ads like that anywhere, and this has been a major difference. I think a lot of what you're seeing at the local level is that kind of fundraising, that kind of spending from outside and inside the state that we didn't see so much a few years ago when three quarters of the candidates were running clean.
Well, we've already had a lively start. We're going to get to some of the other races when we come right back.
Now is the time. If you're ready for a home loan or a home repair, if you want to get behind the wheel of a new vehicle, make it happen with a visit to your local Maine credit union for low loan rates, great terms, and decisions made locally. Everything feels right about a credit union, starting with people who are always willing to work with you. If you want a better way to borrow, join a Maine credit union, your best financial choice. Now is the time.
At MacPage, we believe in developing relationships, earning trust, addressing complex issues, and making a difference. We enjoy the people we serve and care about the work we do, providing integrated accounting, consulting, and tax services to our clients throughout New England and across the country. Please visit us at MacPage.com to learn more.
Hey, check it out. Huh. What happened to that guy?
Hey, get that sign back up!
You're not alone. Together we stand. I'll be by your side. You know I'll take your hand. When it gets cold and it feels like the end, there's no place to go. You know I won't give in. No, I won't give in. Keep holding on. Guess you know we'll make it through. Keep holding on.
We'd like to welcome everybody back, and we have some guests. Let's go back to the U.S. Senate race. And is there anything that we should know about in this from your views?
Well, it's some surprising, as we were talking a few minutes ago before the camera came on, I can't understand why you got a lot of independent expenditures on behalf of Senator Collins. She's outspending Schiavello's 2.5-1. The poll, she's ahead by 20-something points, you know, at the worst. So why are we getting some independent expenditures in that race?
I think Bellows has done a really good job of raising money for a relatively little-known candidate, never been elected to things, but she's running against the most popular United States senator there is, a real Maine institution. What I think is interesting is how much passion there seems to be among Democrats for Bellows' campaign that I don't see as much about the congressional races, that you would think there'd be more passion in the second district. I think some of that's the civil libertarian nature. She's raised money quite well, over $2 million, which is something challengers to Collins haven't always done. But I think the race is a lot less close than most Democrats think that it is.
So let's talk about a big race. Obviously, the 2nd Congressional District has become a target of all kinds of groups from out of state. Yeah. Both the Republicans and Democrats are targeting top-tier open district. So tell us what's going on and what's playing out in this race, and maybe start with you, Jim. Well, you teach in the 2nd seat.
I do. I work there every day. open seats are always the most competitive, always the most money flow. The Republicans have had something, it's bothered them that there hasn't been any Republican seats in the House. I think they rightly see this as a good opportunity for a gain. And it's been very competitive. It's relatively close, very different styles of the candidates. I don't know how much Bruce Poliquin's mended fences within his own party. I've heard people saying Kevin Ray really hasn't necessarily said much about him. But I'm not seeing as much passion for Kane as you would think. Some of that may be that a lot of Democrats really fell in love with Troy Jackson. I'm going to fight. I'm going to stand up for Social Security. And I'm not sure that Emily Kane's really grabbed that really core Democratic voter, even though what she really has to sell is this thing we're seeing in a lot of campaigns. I can work across party lines. I just got a flyer in a House race, local House race, from a Democratic legislator saying the Republican in this race is a good person to vote for because he works across party lines. I think Emily Kane has that to sell, but I think that hasn't quite caught fire. I think it could go either way.
Mal, what do you think on this race?
I've been watching this race very closely, especially on the expenditures, and it's getting outrageous. It used to be $500,000 could run a congressional campaign quite nicely. If you go back not that many elections, we're talking the Republican Congressional Campaign Committee alone is dumping $2 million in the 2nd Congressional District. The Democrats aren't far behind. They've got several political action committees doing it instead of just one, but the amount of money being spent on that race, and it's getting nasty. They're starting to personally attack each other. They're starting to distort each other's records. I covered both of them when they've served in the legislature and when Bruce was state treasurer. And I can tell you both sides are distorting the issues and as to how those two candidates stand. And I can fearlessly predict it's going to get worse.
And going to be close. You think it'll both think it'll be close?
I do. I mean, if you look at the most recent poll, showed Bruce Poliquin up by, I think it was 10 percentage points.
I don't
but it's
buy
a
that.
Real
yeah.
outlier.
Yeah.
None of the other polls show that. They've all been well within margin of error. I think this is going down to the wire if I had to bet one way or another. I think Emily Kane will wind up winning, but it's going to be very, very close.
Don't all the polls in this CD2 race have a high percentage of undecided?
And more importantly, the polling uses such a small sample. The 10% that Jim's talking about has a margin of error of close to 7%.
Yeah.
So when you get that kind of a margin of error, you can't use any of the demographics to try to analyze women, men, income groups, it becomes useless. The stuff I've seen, which is internal party polling on both sides, I will say, shows it within the margin of error. And I think that's where it's going to be. Somebody's going to win that one by a couple of points.
Let's talk about the state legislative races, if we can. You've talked about a couple of mailers that you've received.
Sure.
Professor, how do you see the control of the Senate shaking out?
That is the tight, tight question. I think the House is much more likely to stay in Democratic hands. There are so many really good close races around the state. You've got the Les Fossil Chris Johnson race down in Lincoln County. You've got the race to replace Dick Woodbury, very popular unenrolled candidate. You've got the race in Auburn and the race in Lewiston, all very tight. I think the Republicans have a legitimate chance to come out of this with a majority. Some people think that in some of the rural districts, the bear hunting vote will bring out some Republican conservative voters. I think that's a coin flip. You could see a Governor Michaud having to deal with a Republican state Senate, could see that flip very easily. So many good races around the state this year.
Mel?
I think they got a better shot in the Senate than in the House.
Oh, yeah.
When I look at the House analysis, they just don't have enough candidates running, and the Democrats have too many incumbents. So I don't see a shot, as they did 4 years ago, of taking the House. The Senate, it's a crapshoot.
Wide open.
I mean, there are so many seats that could flip. I think the Republicans could have done a better job on recruiting candidates in the Senate. There's some seats that they did not get the strongest of candidates. They really put up a shell candidate. But overall, the scenario Jim's talking about, you could have a Democratic governor, a Republican Senate, and a Democratic House. And boy, wouldn't that be fun.
Well, I think Hannah and I can both attest that it's probably going to be a couple thousand votes in each chamber that determines control. These are very close, neighbor versus neighbor.
How many recounts is Les Fossil with? Three recounts in the last 10 years? Could happen again.
Saying, all politics is local.
That's right.
Yep. So you two, you both have your ear to the ground, and you follow elections probably even more closely than Josh and I these days. And Jim, you have students who are out literally knocking on doors and helping candidates.
They are.
So tell us, have you heard anything from out in the field that you didn't expect, anything that's going on that everybody else hasn't heard about?
Not so much. I didn't expect, but the students get so shocked when they do phone calls at how much split ticket voting there is.
Yeah.
People equally passionate for, I'm so for Susan Collins and I'm so for Emily Kane.
Yeah.
And that's something that really shocks them. Haven't had any of the really great stories like being chased by goats. I've had a number of students attacked by goats over the years up in Farmington. Yeah. But it's great to see them get out, and they get so much good reception from people.
Yeah.
People are so happy to see young people getting involved in politics, and I think it's fantastic.
Mal, last word for you. What has changed? You've been covering this a long time. Elections 10, 20 years ago. What's different today, or is it the same?
I think there's been huge differences, particularly in legislative races. It used to be all you needed to do was go door to door, greet your neighbors, talk about the issues, what you want to do when you get elected, and that's all you needed to do. Maybe a flyer, maybe a mailer. Now we've got state senate races costing $100,000 with television ads and radio ads and newspaper ads and all of the above. So there's been a huge change in terms of how complex campaigns are and how expensive they are.
Well, we had a great panel today. Mal and Jim, thank you very much. We could have talked to you for 2 hours and learned a lot more, but thank you both for being here, and Josh and I will be right back.
You gotta support the puck. Do I have to tell you this? And we're getting killed on the board. This is your territory, Grimson. Do your job.
Grimson.
Hello?
Oh, hi, honey.
What? Al? All right. The itsy bitsy spider climbed up the water spout. Down came the rain and washed the spider out. Out came the sun and dried up all the rain. And the itsy bitsy spider climbed up the spout again.
I love you, Daddy.
I love you too, sweetheart.
Hey, it's my girl. My daughter.
Love. Pass it on. A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
Welcome back. So, Josh, these two guys have been around a long time, and they've been following races. What do you think?
Yeah, well, for sure, politics in Maine has changed. We know the outside groups are going to spend a lot of money in Maine when the stakes matter. We see the outside spending with the RGA, the DGA, and the other outside groups. It really has changed that main nature of politics.
Yeah, and I mean, Mal, they both talked about it. I mean, Mal had his list of all the spending, and it really is, it's immense. I mean, a lot of money coming in from outside, but, you know, as I think even Mal said himself, so many ads in a row. I mean, do people care? Does that still decide elections? Does money make the difference?
Right. It seems tough to find people down ballot having traction on the airwaves, given so many buys are coming out at the top of the ticket. But, you know, it is interesting to see how this second congressional district is going to play out. I think both acknowledge it's a very close race. And I guess the question we have is anybody paying attention yet?
Yeah. And it is. I mean, people see the TV ads, but how much are they really engaging and how much are they learning about where the candidates really stand on the issues? And, you know, but I think they're right. I think the Senate races really are the battleground. The House will probably stay in Democratic hands. But the Senate, you know, there's some very fierce races out there and they could go either way. And, you know, the public may or may not be paying attention. They might see some flyers in the mail. But, you know, it'll be fun to watch on election night.
I agree. It's going to be great to watch. It's great entertainment. It's high stakes. Yeah. We know how much effort people have put into it. And it's too close to call. But you know something? It was nice to see Mal and actually be able to ask him questions for a change.
Yes, that is very true.
And speaking of somebody it's nice to see, we ought to turn it back to our friend Gary Crocker.
Money in politics. Now, there's a concept worthy of discussion. It may make children weep and grown men cry. So I decided to take a sideways look at the issue to see if I could get my arms around it. What if we went back on the gold standard and everyone had to pay for goods and services with actual gold coins? You know, like if you wanted to buy a side of beef to stick in the freezer to feed your family, you know, you'd have to hand over real gold coins to the butcher. Or say you wanted to buy some ad space in a local paper or time on TV or radio, or some campaign signs to drive deep into lawns or alongside highways and byways. Yeah? You'd have to haul a huge bag of gold coins along with you. You know, so when you went from business to business, you'd be paying with heavy gold bullion. And the advertising gurus who helped you make the case that you, instead of your worthy opponent, should be elected to represent the multitudes? Well, while I'm pretty sure that ain't ever gonna happen, it would paint a wicked clear picture of who was working the hardest to win my vote. Because if you or I spent weeks or months lugging around sacks of heavy gold coins, we'd be in the best shape of our lives. And no one would be lifting more sacks of gold than folks running for office. So it would be a cinch to know who was more committed. He or she would have forearms like Hulk Hogan. And they'd even be able to run up and down stairs without being out of breath one little bit, just to hand you a campaign flyer. So, my thinking is, if we can't get the big money out of politics, let's at least use it to gauge the commitment of the candidates. Anyone willing to haul around the heavy sacks of anything for weeks on end is certainly worthy of consideration. That's the view from where I'm sitting. Oops, gotta go. Mother says I got to lug 25 40-pound bags of wood pellets into the basement so we can fire up the pellet stove. Anyone want to give me a hand?
You know, Gary, honestly, if we were carrying around huge bags, Josh might beat me, although my forearms would be a lot tougher. But, I mean, it is amazing to think about how much money is spent on these elections. And, you know, where does it all go? It goes into TV ads and then it's gone. I mean, it's a little obscene. But
you know, his point is very well taken. Yeah. And money in politics, it's like trying to stop water from going downhill. You just never know. He makes a good point.
It is, even for Gary. Well, it was great to have you here with us today. Josh Tard and I will be back next week. We'll be talking about the battle for the State House. Thank you for joining us tonight.
This program has been brought to you by Logisticare, the nation's leading provider of specialized transportation network management to state and local government clients. By Maine's Credit Unions, now is the time for a credit union. There is one for you. And by MacPage, developing relationships, earning trust, addressing complex issues, and making a difference.